check this out. New streaming date and time, which I need to still update my calendar and. All right. Picking up where we left off. Oh, wow. Video color. Maybe it's my screen. I don't know. I look weird. But it's fine. Maybe it's just dark. So it's we're having a here's how to stay relatively cool and use less electricity. One is to close your blinds completely so you have no light coming in order to prevent stuff from happening. So that's probably why I'm not getting any of my natural light. And I only have my lamp over here. So I might look a little weird today. Hopefully I sound better. Because one thing bad on me, and I never got any feedback about it, but I was on getting all the videos set up and finally properly that comes out loud YouTube channel, getting it from Twitch to YouTube. And I realized, yeah, you can hear me, but the game is a little bit overwhelming, so it's hard to really hear. I turned down the volume a little bit. You should still be able to hear the game, but not as loud. The only issue is when we have like voiceovers and stuff. Speak the volume up. Anyways, we are going to speak to Lucia, who we think is in the congregation. This goes best without for now. My honored friends, as if winning Hreisvelgr to our cause was not enough, you took it upon yourselves to rid us of his brood brother. I know not how to thank you. My only contribution was hardly noteworthy. The true savers of the day were Essagos and Estinian. One triumphed over Nidhoggshade through strength of arms and the other through strength of will. And speaking of Estinian, what news of his recovery? Yajur Grun was conveyed to the infirmary, where he now resides under the care of our hospitalier captain. I am told he has yet to regain consciousness. But as you know, Estinian's mind and body are held hostage for many days. You must be patient and allow the process of healing to begin. In the meantime, we would do well to rest and recover from your own ordeals. But surely, the Emmerich is never long from Estinian's bedside and will send word the moment that there are any developments. Now, if I have satisfied your concerns, I believe Lord Emmont and his sons are eager to celebrate your return. Very well, Frisco. Camasagos, it would seem we are awaited at Fortal Manor. I think we have voiceover.
The heroes of the hour return.
We but did our duty, my lord. It was the memories of fallen friends and not our heroism which saw us through at the last.
I gave every ons of my strength, but mine efforts would have counted for naught had the Warrior of Light not arrived to challenge the Great Worm. As a sworn knight of Ishgard, I had hoped to do more for my city.
Well, we cannot all be heroes, dear brother. Let us put away our pride for a moment and revel in the valiant deeds of our comrade. For your sterling service to Ishgard, we salute you. And while we're on the subject of valiant deeds, I believe I myself have earned some small measure of recognition. Under my watchful command, the ballistas of the Outer Ward struck down a veritable swarm of Dravanian invaders.
My lord's command was certainly watchful. He bravely watched as the siege crews took aim, and continued to watch as countless wyverns met their end. Indeed, the ward's defenders proved so well-drilled that my lord had little occasion to stop watching.
There will be time enough to determine who is most deserving of recognition later. Our friends are doubtless weary from their exertions. I had chambers prepared in expectation of your return. You are welcome to retire at your leisure.
I am most grateful for your hospitality, my lord, but I believe I shall pay a visit to the Temple Knight's infirmary. Pray excuse me.
Our master Alfinor has grown. The plight of his stricken brother in arms pains him more than his own hurts. In which respect he has come to resemble you, Warrior of Light. Go then, visit the Azure Dragoon, and grant him what comfort you may.
Running back and forth. Discuss, my friend. What can I do for the savior of Ishgard? Seek Master Alphinode? Oh, he came to relieve me of my vigil a short while ago. When he begged to sit at Estenian's side, I could not refuse him. Though he would sooner faint than admit it, the boy must be exhausted from Hraesvelgir's trial and all that followed. Estenian is blessed to have such devoted comrades. Yet a transmog item, dragon swelling orchestration roll, and a wind up Emmerich for a couple. My own friendship with this Stinian began some 10 years past, shortly after we joined the Temple Knights. I learned his name soon enough, but a Stinian barely registered my existence. I was less a fellow recruit and more a shadow which occasionally darkened his path. And so I might have remained, had fate not seen fit to intervene. While out on patrol, our company was set upon by a dragon. We were the only two to survive. The experience forged a bond between us, as such life-threatening situations are wont to do. Despite our friendship, he remained an intense and solitary youth, wholly obsessed with claiming vengeance against Nidhogg. Revenge was ever at the forefront of his mind, revenge of the death of his parents, and revenge for his younger brother. I would venture that in Alphinode he sees something of his lost sibling, and in the ungentle chidings of Astinian, Alphino has found the elder brother he never had. Truth be told, Astinian's tactless observations have saved me from disaster more than once, and I can well understand Alphino's affection for him. He is a friend for whom I would gladly... Oh, Commander, your presence is required in the infirmary. Is he? Tell them I'm on my way. Quickly, as the ghost, we must go to him. And now a series of cutscenes. I'm just going to turn the volume up because I think a lot of this is voice. Yeah, I just started my stream. Of course I got plenty of time to watch it. I do like how they warn you. Like, if you've been playing for like 12 hours straight.
Astinian.
Cease your mewling, boy. It grates my ears.
Forgive me. When I saw you awaken, I could not... It was such a relief. We feared you might never wake up.
Now, Astinian. If Master Alphino thought any less of you, you would still be Nidhogg's plaything. Or dead.
Aye, 'twas but a jest. I thank you, Alphino. And you too, Warrior of Light. Quite how you managed to persuade Hraesvogr to aid in his brew brother's downfall, I cannot imagine. But full glad am I that you did. Yet again, you have achieved the impossible.
I, for my part, owe you an apology. When last we met, I did willingly loose an arrow at your heart. Can you forgive me?
There is naught to forgive, Emmerich. You but acted in defense of Ishgard, as is your duty. Were you any less single-minded about it, I would not follow you into battle, nor trust you at my back. Besides, I had come to the selfsame conclusion that I would have to perish for Nidhogg to be stopped. So let us dispense with the hand-wringing. I have heard enough mewling for one day.
Oh!
The tendrils of Nidhogg's foul presence bound up every fiber of my being. Usurping my senses, but I yet retain some trace of awareness. The worm's mind was as a vast and tumultuous sea. Endlessly its black waters churned, his grief and despair at Ratatoska's murder never calming, never receding. And driven by this surging current came wave upon wave of unrelenting rancor. It was the very image of my own heart. There I saw the dark reflection of the hatred I felt after Nidhogg slew my family. When no path remained save vengeance against dragonkind. Neither one of us had a choice. But I was blessed with something Nidhogg was not. comrades and teachers to console and admonish me. Had I not had them to gainsay my obsession, it would surely have consumed me as Nidhogg's did him, and we would have been in all respects alike. Though his shade is banished, his spirit scattered upon the sea of clouds, I feel no joy at his passing. Where once I craved vengeance, I now crave rest. Lord Commander, my hunt is at an end. I would lay down the mantle of Azure Dragoon.
My friend. He has tired himself with too many words. I doubt not that he will make a full recovery, but he must be allowed some few days of quiet. I too must see my path to its end. Sleep well, my friend.
Following the battle with Nidhogg on the steps of Faith, Sir Emery called an assembly that he might make his final proclamation as acting head of state. T'was there, with one decree, that the 1,000-year rule of the archbishops was ended, paving the way for a new republic. The governance of Ishgard would now be placed in the hands of high and lowborn alike, their ranks represented by the newly founded House of Lords and House of Commons. Church was separated from state. The foundation for change had been carefully laid, and the reforms proposed by Ishgard's new government passed into law without incident. His duty done, Emmerich de Borel gladly stepped down from the Archbishop's dais, only to be raised unto the highest seat in the House of Lords.
You're not going to get off that easy.
Though he strove at first to refuse this honor, the unexpectedly strident voice of the Count de Durandere left him little choice but to accept. And so it was that the winds of gentle revolution came to stir. Prominent among the many honored guests at Sir Emmerich's investiture were the ambassadors of Dragonkind, a fitting symbol of Ishgard's newfound peace. The people looked on in awe as he soared through the heavens on dragon back. And by their cheers did they hail him an Azure Dragoon for a new age. Thus were the notes of the dragon song rewritten, the din of war giving way to a rising litany of peace and hope.
Memoirs of Count Edmund de Fulton, Evansward. Hi, Richardo. Yeah, it's mainly because I have the blinds completely closed, so I'm not getting the natural light coming in. And then my only lamp is this one. And I don't know why it's showing blue. But it seems fine, considering my theme for Essigos here is, well, blue. I mean, crawling getting new gear is. This gear is blue. Red Mage is, well, kind of blue because it still is. Gunbreaker, I'm not sure if I can even dye this. I don't think it's dyeable. I don't know. I do know the light bulb in that, I actually picked specifically to be more of a yellow to kind of soften the color to warm the color of the light, so I don't know if that has any effect on it. It's fine. Look, the important stuff is what's over here. This window is just so you can see me talking to you. The only thing it is. Unbreaker quest. He'll do that later. I obviously don't have the Straw Engine one because I boosted it to level 70. Anyway, back here. I was gazing out at the sea of clouds, and in an all too rare moment of idleness, when I had a chance to behold a certain hero wending his way toward this. His way towards the city on Dragonback. Welcome home, Messenger. Nay, 'twas no grave matter that moved me to greet you in person. Between you and me, I merely sought respite from the pressures of office. No sooner do I surrender my role as temporary head of state than I am burdened with a position of more permanent responsibility. Yeah, it's fine. You missed it when I started the stream, and I noticed that the colors, I'm like, why does my red chair look blue? Like, I think there was an update to the Twitch Studio's streaming software. It might have done something, I don't know. And then I'm like, if I let natural light in, does that fix it? It kind of does. Kind of purple. I don't know. Look, I have did nothing with the camera. Nothing. So. Anyways, moving on. Get back to the story. I fancy that it echoes in some small measure the way you must feel when your improbable feats of heroism are rewarded. And turn the game volume down because I said that I don't care about the caps unless you're constantly doing caps. I don't really. Turn the volume on my. So I was actually working on finally catching up on my video exports from Twitch to YouTube. And I watched one of the videos because I'm like, oh, what was I doing during this video? I was watching it, and then I'm like, oh my god, the game sounds are so loud. I could barely hear myself. I can hear I'm there, but it's kind of distracting. So I'm like, okay, I need to make sure that I turn the game volume down on the stream. I can turn it up when we have things such as the long cutscenes that we just had. Basically the end of the Dragon Song War. It's done. Right now, it's just... I think we've gotten to the point because we're getting to... Yeah. We're getting to the end of the patch 3.3, so we have 3.4 and 3.5 and 3.56 patches to do. It's a total of a... quests, or like 1920 quests before we go into Stormblood. So usually the 0.4 and 0.5 patches is really okay. Everything regarding this expansion is essentially over. Let's work on our transition to the next expansion. A few minor things might happen and then move on into that next expansion. That's where we're at. Anyways, back to story. My overlay is working, so I can notice when people are chatting without having to look over to my left. That's true. I'm not... Yeah, I haven't read it in a while. Like, actually, like, group rated. I think I've retired from that. I thoroughly enjoyed my time with the scheduled raids. Because back in Wrath of the Lich King, I was like, huh, I wonder if there's anybody in the guild that is doing like Naxxramas during this time that I could join. Oh, here's a 25 man group we're doing. Great! They go in and it was a blast. And got into a group to do Old War, Trial of the Champion, or Trial of the Crusader. And oh my god, I was able to nerd screen killing the Lich King in Wrath of the Lich King. And I had originally started as a Feral Druid. I love Trial of the Crusader. A lot of people don't, because it's the whole, it's just like just one room and boss fight. Okay, so you do transition into another room at the very end, but it's just boss fight. The dungeon was interesting. The dungeon, the Trial of Champion. But it's annoying to solo Trial of the Champion. I was working on getting, because I love the raid tier set from Trial of the Crusader. But to access the raid, you had to complete the Trial of the Champion at least once, I think, to unlock it or something like that. And so oh, Draxa. Didn't his like daughter like try to get revenge on us somewhere? Was it a wife or something? Oh, Wrath of the Lich King. Then I kind of took a break. I did a teensy bit of raiding in Cataclysm with an alliance guild that I was in. Then I really didn't do any major raiding until the end of Pandaria, where I started off just on a flex raid team. But due to some frustrations with that, we separated. And then I got onto an alliance raid team who I didn't quite realize they were set to get through mythic content, or heroic at the time. And I was like, oh my god. And the first time I did a heroic boss fight, I panicked. I was like, ah! Oh my god! Ah! Eventually I calmed down and got used to it. I was like, oh my god. It was so much fun though. It was exhausting because and soul crushing at times, be like, wipe after wipe after wipe. But it's like, just go in. But there was just, and we did that all the way through the end of Warriors of Draenor. And then that guild kind of fell apart because of reasons. And I didn't really do anything until a little bit into Legion. Oh, the first fight of Siege of Orgrimmar on heroic. And Trial of the Champion. Trial of the Crusader was too. Of course, I never did heroic content. I didn't do heroic content until the end of Pandaria with Siege of Orgrimmar. I do remember the angel. Well, they're They were the Valkyr. It was one light, one dark. It was some... You know, out of content, context, people would think interesting things about the, oh my God, balls everywhere. If anything, I turned into an LFR hero. But that's fine. And then eventually here, we're working on trying to get everybody up to Shadowlands content. And working on, basically, I've just been turning into a transmogor. I'm really in it more for the mog. Would look good. And weird completionist goals. Like, so it started off, okay, I'm going to have one of each class in each faction. I'm going to have a Death Knight in Horde. I'm going to have a Death Knight in Alliance. Just going to get them all the max level. This is back in Pandaria. I decided to do this. So it's like, all right, we've got 11 classes. Great. 22 tunes. Woo! I was short by one. I think it was just a couple of levels. However, Warlord's Drainer, I did it. I got all 22 classes to max level. Oh. And then I was like, okay, now what? Okay, so I need to do transmog. But sadly, they didn't have sets for like the LFR sets were different than the actual normal raid sets. Normal, heroic, and mythic. So that would have been too difficult to go through that. So whenever we got a chance to do some other content, I tried to get on to a different tune and such. And then I tried to get the mog for my Death Knight that I was raiding on. And Legion came around, added another class. I'm like, okay, so now instead of 22 tunes, it's 24 because I've got to have a Demon Hunter in each. Then they add Allied Races. I'm like, oh, I need to unlock these Allied Races. I'm going to unlock these Allied Races. I should probably have a tune of the Allied Race. So I did that. Oh, wait a minute. This is going to give me weird numbers because, well, in order to get the transmog for the Allied Race, I need to like level them up to from lowest level to from level 20 because they start at level 20 up to max level, or actually I think it might have been just like 90 years, and then I can get the transmog for that. But that means I'm going to have to do a new character for that, but that's going to make it weird because I wanted one of each class in each. Oh, each class has multiple specs. You have, they have an average of 3 specs. There's 12 classes. Times 3, that's 36. There we go. I just need one of each spec. And I'll just divide them between each faction. Like, that answers everything. And so I did that. Then I realized, and they opened Battle for Azeroth. Oh, new Allied Races. Yeah. I deleted a couple of the new characters I made because I was trying to fill out spots and I was using old races. Now I started them over on the new races. Leveled them up. At the end of BFA, 36 dunes, max level. Oh, by the way, we also have mechanomes in Volpira that we had later in the expansion. I'm like, yeah, already got 36 tunes to max level. Oh well. Bank alts. There we go. Now I have 38 tunes. I just leveled up Volpira and I paid Mechanome to get their resource transbox. And I'm like, okay, so I don't really have to deal with these. These are not required. I can just leave them in capital cities and use them as bank alts. Fine. Don't have to worry too much about them. But I can at least say I have them. Unlock the transmog. So for some reason, I decide to race change one of my other characters to one of these races. Fine. They have the mog already, you know. So that's where my obsession comes in. But then they also do heritage armor for old races. This is why I like WoW a lot. Although I haven't played it in months. Mainly because I've been currently obsessed with this game. And I will frequently say differences in what I think could make the game better based off of my experience with WoW. Again, I want to say this outright. I don't think either game is better than the other. They're each better at certain things. Like Final Fantasy XIV, much, much better at the story. However, their transmog, which they refer to call glamour, is shit. They didn't learn from WoW on the best way to satisfy everybody's need, because one of the big things that people say about Final Fantasy XIV is glamour is the end game. You gotta look good. Here's my problem. And I don't think they even... Somebody's got to have mentioned this, or there's got to be like some sort of Reddit thread. There's got to be a bunch of feedback to the devs regarding glamour. And one of that, and I think there are plenty of systems or plenty of other games in place that have these type of systems. WoW didn't have it to begin with. WoW had a similar thing to what we have here, where you basically have to have the item in order to use it for glamour in some way, shape, or form. You can put in a glamour dresser, throw it on a glamour plate, and then when you're in a big city, you can use the glamour plate for the look. And if you have it in your inventory, you could individually mod it, or glamour. However, in order to do all this, you have to have glamour prisms, which really, as you go on and actually start working with your grand company, you end up getting a shit ton of company seals. Well, there's plenty of in-game stuff that you can use those company seals on. One of the things you can do is for 200 company seals, you can get a glamour prism or a glamour dispeller. I think it's 200. because of how many, it's 200. When you get up to max rank in your grand company, you can have the cap for company seals is 90,000. And I will tell you this, it is easy to do that the later you are into the game. Because one of the things is, as you rank up in your grand company, one of the things you can do is get it, one of the features you get is what's referred to as expert delivery. Basically, any of that dungeon gear that you get, or old gear that you have that maybe you don't want for glamour, or it's a repeat. You already got it. You got it in your glamour dresser. You don't need it anymore. Now, you could just sell it to an NPC. It's bound to you, so you can't really sell it on the market board. So what do? You can go to your grand company and give it to them, and they'll give you seals. The later in the game that the item is from, like if you have a Shadowbringers, like max level dungeon piece of gear, you can turn it into it for like 1,700 company seals. As you may end up grinding dungeons, you can greet all that roll, or because of a feature in Shadowbringers called Trust, where you can basically solo an instance and you've got three NPCs helping you along with it. May not be as efficient of doing it, but to me it's more calming. And then you get every single piece of loot that is in that dungeon. And you can turn it all into your company or company seals. Glamour prisms, easy to get. The currencies, that's you have to have a thing in order to use the glamour system. Obviously, you can save money by throwing it into the glamour dresser and using glamour plates. Because once you put it into the dresser, that's one and done, one prism, that's it. And then you can use the glamour plates over and over without spending anything else. So, great. But here's how they could improve this system. This is my idea on how they could improve this system. Is they need to look to other games I am aware of, and I believe there are some other games that I don't know specifically, but I believe there are other games that do the same type of thing. Instead of having to deal with all of this systems in order to use glamour, maybe instead of, you know, having a glamour dresser where you have to put the item in, what if you received an item, and as long as it's considered bound to you, basically the only way to sell it is either to turn it into your grand company or vendor it. You learn the appearance. Then you can get rid of it. They could just use the glamour dressers as a way to access the interface of your collection. Exactly. But here's the thing is, do you know who did it before? One of the games that did it before WoW? Diablo. Diablo 3 had the transmog system this way before WoW. Basically, you get a collection. You get the appearance collection. And then the glamour plates are essentially like just like in WoW where you create sets in the glamour plates. And what would be really cool is they've also is what I would really, really like is if they had a mount which had vendors on it. Maybe it sold food, provide repairs, and then there's also the option to, you know, glamour. Although you can actually glamour yourself at any glamour plates. I don't know. I think there's some restrictions, or you could pop onto them so that you talk to this NPC, or you talk to or you select this item that's on your mount, or maybe it's just like a toy or something. I don't know. That you can talk to it, and then you can use it to, like, you just got some new piece of gear. You put it on, it's great, but it looks ugly. And well, I don't have the piece of gear I want to glamour it to on me to use my cast glamour feature. I want to do it from the appearance. Well, since we could do the cast glamour, if we go by the collections, maybe we could just do it like that. You pull up your collections, you find the one you're looking for, you select it, and cast the glamour on your item, one at a time. I don't know. Maybe continue using glamour prisms as a currency, because in WoW, we just you every time you transmog, you use gold. Unless you're transmogging it to invisible, then it's free. Anyways, that's my rant. Get back in the game. Where was I? Fancy that it echoes in small measure the way you must feel with your improbable feats of heroism. Are rewarded, but still more impossible challenges. The myth which guided our society for generations lies in tatters. Am I then to be scorned for building upon this system of debility that I once sought to tear down? What strange jest is this that places me at its pinnacle, an archbishop's bastard son at the head of the House of Lords. But these questions are for me to answer. This is not in man's nature to change overnight. This I learned through painful experience, and it was this hard lesson that convinced me to take the path which we now follow. Even as we rebuild the bridge between man and dragon, so must we reimagine Ishgard, one carefully placed stone at a time. We must remember that it is not for us that we lay this groundwork, but for the men and women of our children that our children will become. May their towers rise proudly from the fundament of our legacy. Fundament? You might watch. Here, word from Captain White Cape that Astinian has vanished from the sick room. His willfulness survives undiminished. Should you ever happen upon our unmannerly friend in your travels, pray assure him that I shall keep Ishgard safe until he deigns to come home. Thank you, Yasagos, and please convey my warmest regards to Master Alphino. I'm not sure if you saw it or people remembered, but the reason why I'm at the airship landing during that scene was because the previous cutscene that was before it, I was flying around on Midgard Stormer with Hrisfelger. And so we flew around for a while, you know, had a fine time, and then we flew back on Midgard Stormer to here, and when I landed, there was Ceramic. Saw me flying in. Back to Fortal Minna. You spoke with Sir Emmerich. Do not envy his new position. Ishgard has chosen a new road, but one littered with the detritus of the thousand years of broken faith. Yet, though we, her people may stumble from time to time, I know of none better than Sir Emmerich to lead the march of progress. As for us, that remains a small matter of ushering in a new dawn in the shadow of inscrutable Asian machinations and seemingly endless procession of primals. But we too must walk our chosen path, no matter how treacherous the footing. In the wake of Ishgard's governmental reform, new airship routes have been sanctioned. You may now travel to the selection of distant locales from the landing in Ishgard. Thought that would have voiceover. Oh wait, there's more. Not sure if it's voiceover there. Nope. Thank you, Blind Hands. Nay, you need not remain there. We shall rendezvous at the usual place. All is proceeding as expected, then. Aye, there is naught to concern us, aside from one overly curious mouse. This way. Him again. It is of no moment. They will play their part and we will play ours. And thus did gray mists give way to azure skies. Men and dragon rise above, voices joined in song, and beneath shrouded boughs, behold, beyond the scope of light, shadow stirs. Welcome to the next chapter of Heaven's Word. We are now in 3.4 content. That little achievement of Floor the Horde. Master Windspawn, Master Windspawn, we have come at some most excellent time. An invitation from a truly preeminent personage was delivered to the manor but a short while ago. Would that you were present to receive it, but in any event, Sir Emmerich de Borel, Lord Speaker of the House of Lords, Lord Commander of the Temple Knights, and Viscount of House Borel, cordially invites Master Winsmall to dine with him at his estate. You seem surprised. The messenger assured me that his lord had broached the subject with you at an earlier date, when the arrangements of the peace conference was still being finalized. Of course, the intervening moons afforded little opportunity for leisure, but with the happy advent of peace, it's plain the Lord Commander sees no further cause to delay. What say you? But what should I wear? You'd ask me. Well, I'm sure there's a personal friend of Ceramic you are at liberty to wear whatever you deem appropriate. That said, when in doubt, a man of note would do far worse than an alpine coat. At least that's what Lord Emmeline has been heard to say. When you are ready, pray report to the Astrolysium. A man of House Burrell shall be waiting in near there to escort you the rest of the way. So I'm just going to do what I did on my main character and stick with what I'm wearing right now. I'm like, okay, so I got an alpine coat right on. Do you know how uncomfortable Essigos would be in this? I mean, this is the same cloak that Count Edmund de Fulton wears, and it looks good on him. On Essigos? No fucking way. In my main character's headcanon, Essigos is a reckless, mad, a powder keg of a Lalafell. He is short, he is small. Everything about him is so small, and people keep thinking that he's fragile and okay. And he's like, I am tough as nails. I can beat the fucking crap out of you. Don't call me small. That sort of thing. He gets mad easily when people think that he's like some sort of weakling just because he's small. But he could beat up at the strongest Rogan that you could find. And his times is fine. And he does that, and to show his strength, he uses his fists. He's a monk. He is a pugilist. He will beat the fucking shit out of you. You make him angry. Don't make him angry. You don't want to see Essigos when he's angry. Spitfire is... I'm trying to find that phrase. I mean, he has anger management. He's a kind sort of guy. It's just... You want a piece of me? You want a piece of me? Beat the crap out of you. Yeah, which is one of the reasons why I'm happy that I decided to keep him as, but he's basically, so here's my headcanon. Elagos is the Warrior of Light. He, when he came out to, he traveled, he actually is from Vilbrand. He traveled to Limsa Lamensa, but he's always been one. He was decided that he wanted to adventure. He didn't want to stay at home. He was bored and just not very happy. He wanted to go on adventures. And he was very much a guy who uses his fists. He didn't need a weapon. Like, and he's willing to protect his family and friends and everything. He'll wrestle at Arak. If it's endangering his family farm, you know, he's a farm boy sort of thing. Eventually, one day his dad and mom saw the wanderlust and it had gotten to a point where he stayed behind. He was initially staying behind as like duty to help his parents, help at the farm, everything like that. Just like nice old thing. He would, fish, everything like that. Yep. This is Vilbrin's, the isle, everything. One day, his dad tosses him adventurer's outfit that basically your regular Rogadin standard initial armor when you first start the game, and tells him there's a pugilist guild in Ulta, which I think might suit, and gave him some money and says, and basically encouraged him. It's like, you know what? I know. You go be the adventurer that you're meant to be. Help people. Because that's who you are. We'll be fine. Travels to Lipsa Lamenza to see about getting on a ferry to head over to Vesper Bay to go to Ulda. While he's in kind of a layover in Lipsa Lamenza, he's like on the upper decks, kind of looking out the sea, kind of enjoying the sea air. And he meets this older Rogadin gentleman, and they end up starting talking. He talks about his hopes and dreams about what he wants to be in. That he's going to Ulda. Next thing we know, this man invites him to dinner. And they go and he takes him to the Bismarck, the fancy pants diner. And they chat until a member of the Maelstrom comes running up and says, "Storm Marshal, the Admiral is in need of your guidance," or something like that. You know, basically he's being summoned. And he apologizes and says, "I hope to see you again." And that is basically the start of the romance arc with Enzar Slofferson, the Grand Marshal of the Maelstrom that Elagos has. In the end, Elagos gets on his boat, start of game at that point in time. He goes, signs up to the Adventurers Guild, goes to the Pugilist Guild, signs up there, and while he's there, as he walks in, there's Essigos talking to the guild, to the guild receptionist, like spouting all of his virtues of what he could do, and that despite he can hit anybody that's twice his size. And basically they end up joining the guild together at the same time. And they do some quests together and such, become friends. Elagos knows the capacity that Essigos has. He will, as the relationship grows, he will, do the kind of like little poke of and tease him about being so small, even though he knows, so what, you're small, that doesn't matter. Anyways. But in this course of things, Elagos ends up, you get to that point where Your guild master says, oh, you can join other classes. So while he's going adventuring, whenever he's in one of the major cities, he goes and looks into the other classes. Whenever he goes to one of these other places, these other guilds, he meets up with someone new. And eventually, he gets all the classes. We get to the point where the level 15 and we have our starter dungeon. He's like, huh, I need some friends to help me out with Sestasha here. So he goes and checks in with a few of his friends. They form a party and they do Sestasha. And it ends up being that basically there's Elagos, who's essentially every single job, like the warrior light in the game is. Like, here, I'm a monk, I'm a gunbreaker, I'm a astrologian, I'm a red mage, a dancer, archer, machinist, white mage, blue mage, summiter slash black mage, arcanist slash scholar summiter, samurai, rogue, lancer, the dark knight, gladiator, your marauder. You know, he can do everything, but he has this like group of people who, while he's doing one job, he's got other people to do the other. Yeah. It's headcanon. Plain and simple. Essigos also has been in Nolda, and he has wooed Pippin, the vice marshal of the Immortal Flames. And although he is a serpent, he is a part of the Order of the Twin Adder, he has an apartment in the goblet here all done. Headcanon. All headcanon. This is true for me. for you guys, I'm completely different. Anyways, let's continue the story. Greetings and well met. We're actually about to go into a few things. I need to refresh my coffee, and I need to pee. So I'm going to be right back. Shouldn't take too long. We'll actually get back to the story. Greetings and well met, Master Winsmore. I have the honor and privilege to serve as head steward of House Burrell, though admittedly our staff is somewhat smaller than those of other noble families, being countable on one hand. My lord will be overjoyed to hear that you have accepted his invitation, as you will soon see. Yes, spared no expense. I dare say a man of action such as yourself enjoys nary a moment's respite. Aye, the battlefield beckons even now, I'm sure. But for this day, we bid you lay down your burdens and raise a glass to peace and prosperity. I believe we have some VO. Grab the line.
To think the Moogles would prove such harsh taskmasters. Forgive me. I did not know you had suffered so in your quest for the horn. I must say, your spirited accounts always come as a welcome change from the arid reports which fill my days. Though I have lived in these lands my entire life, to hear you speak of them, there is much and more I have yet to see. Truly, yours was a marvelous journey.
Well, it wasn't all sunshine and lemon cakes.
Nor would I presume to imply otherwise. Neither I nor any man alive can truly understand what you have endured, and I cannot say with any confidence that I would have acquitted myself as well under the circumstances, much less grown stronger for it. By your deeds, you have helped us to lay the foundation for lasting reform. The formation of the Republic is but the beginning, for it is not only our system of governance which must needs change. We, the people, must learn to let go of our hatreds and rise above our bloody past. I only pray that I live long enough to see us achieve some measure of success, that I might know the lost did not die in vain. I can still see you there on the steps of faith, striding fearlessly towards the worm. If you could do that, who are we to balk at the challenges ahead? The question of how best to strengthen ties with the other great nations of Eorzea has been debated at length in the Lords and Commons of late. As you may imagine, maintaining stability during this period of historic upheaval is our paramount concern. Nevertheless, we are greatly indebted to the Alliance for their support during the Grand Melee, and it would be remiss of us not to repay their faith in kind. Of course, we owe you the greatest debt of all, and it is my hope that in extending our support to you and the Scions, we might also express our gratitude to our neighbors, nay, our fellow Eorzeans, whom we pray you will continue to protect. The Lords and Commons agree on very little, but not a soul in either house begrudges your order this offer of patronage. For all you have done and will do, we thank you. May I ask a personal question? Now that the dust has settled, what will you do? Not as a scion, I mean, but what do you want for yourself?
Lord Commander, pray forgive the interruption.
News from House Fulton.
An urgent message for the Warrior of Light. I was instructed to deliver it without delay. Master Thancred returned to the manor a short time ago, bearing an injured maiden. Master Leveur and Mistress Tataru are tending to her wounds, but they like not her chances. Respectfully, my lord, they have requested the Warrior of Light's immediate presence.
You must go to them, my friend, and I shall go with you.
For every ending marks a new beginning. From tragedy and sacrifice, we rise to greet a new dawn, as did he. Only to be drawn unto another battlefield, another cause, as if by fate.
Different area. Okay, so I'm going to make a quick preface here. One thing that wasn't part of the main story quest, but was part of the end game of A Realm Reborn, was a series of savage raids, although they've never been marked as savage, but the difficulty is the equivalent of what's referred to as savage raids, which is kind of like heroic and WoW. Yeah, normal, heroic, I think, sort of thing. Well, they only have like normal, and then, which is actually more like Raid Finder for their normal, my opinion. So they don't really have much for difficulty when it comes to normal and savage. That's it. They don't have like the four different levels that WoW has. Raid Finder, the normal, heroic, mythic. But they had a series of raids, follow up on the original 1.0 of Final Fantasy XIV, where at the end of Final Fantasy XIV was the Battle of Carcanoe, where Bahamut was freed from his prison in the smaller moon Dalamud, and Louis Soir, who's been mentioned several times here, performed a great sacrifice spell thing to try to find him. Certain thing happens, and we find out that a resolution to what happened there, and we find that for some reason, there's some sort of Alagon or old world systems that are basically maintaining Bahamut underneath the earth. or in the middle of Hyaline. And there are some sort of what's referred to as, they refer to as binding coils. There's a series of raids for the first coil, second coil, third coil, and final coil. And during that, Alize, Alphino's sister, who we did see at the beginning with him during the initial part of Realm Reborn, but they were in Uldah, they were talking, and then Alize got fed up on something and went off on her own. Alize ends up recruiting the Warrior of Light to help her investigate the binding coils of Bahamut. They go through these many layers, and they find that there's something maintaining Bahamut's presence in Eorzea, underneath Eorzea. It looks like systems that were in place from the Alagons who imprisoned him up in the moon of Dalaman. And those pieces came crashing down. It was now being bound and being maintained, but it wasn't like fully complete per se. Alize figures that, hey, if we can go to each of these coils and turn them off, that will, because there isn't as much presence or anything feeding this primal of Bahamut, because this isn't like the original Bahamut. The original Bahamut's dead. Yamat told us that. So this is just a shade. This is the shade that was summoned by Tiamat. Not on purpose. After some Asian machinations to get her to do it. So, by essentially turning off all these coils, we're able to free the world from Bahamut's return. However, one of the things they found was a shade of Luiswa, who had become tempered by Bahamut. By shedding all these sounds and defeating him, we were able to essentially free his spirit, pass on. There's more to it, more specifics. It's not part of the main story quest, so it's not part of my videos. But I give you that background. So, in essence, we say that the Warrior of Light went through the binding coils of Bahamut. And that's where we'll get a reference to it here. Otherwise, you get confused if you have no idea what it's talking about.
Is that Alize, Alphino's twin sister? She ran afoul of the Warriors of Darkness. I had been tracking them since the ceremony at Falcon's Nest. Little did I know I was not the only one. Evidently, she had learned of their activities and attempted to shadow them on her own. Poorly. I rescued her in the Twelves Wood, and together we fled north. But though I made every effort to cover our tracks, they caught up with us on the Ishgardian border. And in the ensuing struggle, Alize took an arrow to the shoulder. It was only after we had made good our escape that I realized it was poisoned.
Thank you for coming so quickly. And you, Sir Emmerich.
Think nothing of it. How is she?
We have done all we can for now. Although the immediate danger has passed, the poison yet lingers in her blood. We came to Eorzea together. hoping to bring salvation to the realm our grandfather gave his life to protect. But when confronted with the bitter realities of its politics and its petty powermongers, she was driven to anger and to doubt. She refused to become embroiled in what she termed Eorzea's squabbles and distance herself from the Scions. Though she remained hopeful of a brighter future, she would walk her own path. Would that it had not been so perilous. For all our differences, she's as dedicated as any Scion to the salvation of Eorzea. But more than that, she is my sister. To be reunited with her, only to lose her forever. Gods, even to speak the words.
Take heart, Master Alfino. She will be attended by our most skilled Kyrugians.
Bear Mistress Leveilleur to the infirmary at once. Apprise Captain Whitecape of the situation, and inform him that she is to be treated as my personal charge.
Wait, don't go. Please, come closer. The Warriors of Darkness are in league with the Ascients. Slaughtering the Primals is but the first step in their plan. They make for Zelfatol to bring about Garuda's summoning, and to kill her. You must stop them.
I shall inform the others at once.
Master Thancred, I would ask that you accompany Mistress Leveilleur to the infirmary. Your knowledge of her injuries may well prove useful in determining her treatment.
Of course.
Surely they won't let her. Yes, I know. Must trust in Captain Whitekeep and his Kyrugians. Did they not bring Estinian back from the very brink of death? I'm uncomfortably reminded of how he mocked me for praying at his bedside for days on end. What say you, my friend? Shall we turn our attention to matters whose conclusion we have yet to have the power to influence? Have some food. A little extra XP, right? While we're at it. So the Warriors of Darkness and the Ascients are conspiring to bring about Garuda's summoning, that they may put her to the sword. And when we first encountered them in Lothas Nath, when they were confronting Ravana, gods. Was this been their aim all along? What do you intend to do, Master Alfino? There's much more I do not understand, but I know this. A primal summoning cannot be ignored. Elise risked her life to uncover this, and we squander her gift as our peril. Esagos, will you accompany me to Zelfatol and help me stop the Ixil ritual? Count on me. Given that Ishgard shares a border with the Ixal homeland, we have vested interest in the outcome of this ritual. We have been willing to suffer the Beastmen's intrusions into Corthan lands to a point, but the summoning of a primal is an escalation we cannot abide. You shall have our fastest You shall have our fastest airship, Master Alphino. The mountains of Zelfathal are not easily traversed, and their endeavor demands all haste. The gesture is most appreciated, Ceramic. I fear an aerial approach is destined to fail. This is their homeland, after all, and Ixal dirigibles are not to be underestimated. No, experience tells me the most conceivable approach is by land. I believe it'd be wiser to cross into Zelfathal by way of the mountain pass each of Camp Dragonhead. In that case, I shall send instructions for a contingent of the camp's knights to be placed at your disposal. They will secure your safe passage through the mountains and escort you thence to Zelfathal. Though my men are unqualified to confront a primal, they are more than capable of contending with the Ixal. You should be glad for their assistance, Lord Edmund. In the event Mistress Elise regains consciousness, we will share with you any information she may provide. May the Fury watch over you and keep you safe. And let us be off. We can procure additional supplies we require at Camp Dragonhead. I don't think we'll have any VL for a while, so I'm too. Alright. Camp Dragonhead. Have you everything you require, then? Excellent. The entrance to the pass is north of Nadalon and due east of Camp Dragonhead. Though it is normally guarded by a score of Ixal warriors, I have been informed that House Fulton knights have already been dispatched. The enemy's gates lie open. We need but walk through. Master Winsmore, Master Elfno, as you see, the gate is ours. Be advised that scouts have reported increased activity around the first mountain. Simply put, they are up to something and I don't want anyone interfering. We stand ready to escort you to Zelfathal and aid you as you see fit. Given the numbers we are likely to encounter, a two-pronged approach may be best. While the knights and I feign a larger attack to draw the Ixal attention, I suggest you and yours attempt to slip past their defenses and locate the site of the summoning ritual. If the gods are good, we should only have to deal with some few patrols, but if they are not, we may be forced to do battle with the Warriors of Darkness. Alright, I'm going to queue as a monk and see the time, because you know, this is one of the things. I'm trying to do this on stream. I don't want to just be like sitting around all day. Oh, average wait time 5 minutes. That should be fine. I mean, worst case scenario, I would have just popped on. Gunbreaker. A tanker healer. In the meantime, what I can do, take it in my squadron. This is one of those things where after the dungeon I exit, it's going to teleport me back here. Oh. Look, that's more important. Supporting somebody in relationship struggles. Now go make your cappuccino and pee. Cutter has returned for the deployment. Oh, geez. Go pee. Go now. Hey. All right, they're still in their 20s. Can't quite do the 30s. Let's do some more. My little website thing. Okay, this is getting longer. I might end up switching. One of the things I do need to do eventually, probably side content, is to help increase my rank is manned missions. Where I basically do dungeons. And I need to do at least five regular there are 5 dungeons with them. Oh. All right. I'm going to leave the queue and try with a different class. There we are. God, I love astrologian. Whee! Question is he going to stop or keep going? He's going to keep going. Hopefully the volume is much better. Man. The luck is to the ranged. We haven't gotten to anything into too like massive precarious, so I haven't felt the need to go ahead and use my divination. It is kind of odd that oh, there we go. Well, crap. I did the divination just as we killed him. Maybe I should have just held off. The question is, do they pull? Because I'm watching cutscene. Actually, I think like three of us are. I don't know. There's only two. Ah, shoot. Not what I wanted to do. Well, it's supposed to be less so you can hear me better. Hey, Dancer, join us when it's stack for the stack up markers, will you? We want it. Yay! Everybody left before I got finished watching that cutscene. Speaking of cutscenes.
Thank the gods. What happened?
Prevented the summoning.
Better not have killed the Primal without us.
You!
Wait, I know you. Still walking, I see. I could have sworn my aim was true.
Just what is your game? Leading us the long way so these fools could step in and claim our prize?
Now, let's not make hasty accusations. By the look of things, the ritual was proceeding as planned. We arrived at the appointed hour. It was they who erred.
It is hopeless. We cannot face them all.
Do mine ears deceive? A boy! So that's the way of it. Twins! You had me worried for a moment there. Know that I will happily make it quicker for you. If you just stand still.
Enough, Jarumo. We wouldn't want to upset the man in white with any unnecessary bloodshed now, would we? You've been awfully busy since we were kind enough to spare your lives.
While you were idly consorting with the Asians, you mean? Seven hells! What could you possibly hope to achieve?
Should I explain it to you? Very well. Consider it a reward of sorts for beating us here. You know the tale of Hydaelyn and Zodiac, I take it. Of the great sundering and the reflections it created.
Across 10 and 3 they were divided. Reflections of the source, each possessed of shards of light and dark.
Just so. One of those reflections, the one nearest to the source, is our home. And we were the heroes blessed with her light. But not all worlds hold light and dark in equal measure. In ours, the power of light was greater by far. So the Asians, who once threatened our home, were no match. And they fell before us, one after another, till none were left. Victory, we thought.
And then came the light. A flood of pure, blinding radiance, annihilating shadow and color and life itself. Ere long, it will consume our world, leaving naught in its wake but blank perfection.
That cannot be. Do you honestly expect us to believe such a story?
Believe what you like. But it has happened before, on a world far removed from ours. The 13th, which was swallowed by the dark and transformed into what you call the void. Unchallenged light would condemn us to a similar fate. And so we joined hands with our former enemies, and with their aid came here, to the source. For there is but one way to restore the balance and save our home. The Ardor. Calamitous destruction with the power to break down the barriers between planes and see our worlds rejoined.
You would doom our world to save your own? What would even become of us? Of you?
Enough. I tire of talking. You know our cause. You know what is at stake. We are prepared to do whatever it takes. Are you?
If there is aught you would say, say it. Otherwise, begone. You have no friends here.
Dun, dun, dun. Volume back down. All things considered, we should be grateful to us about that encounter. Do you think it could be true that to save their world, they must bring ruin to ours? No, it matters not. Such wanton destruction is beyond justification. Whatever their reasons, they must be stopped. Sacrifice lost, it ends here.
Well, I think I might be bringing it down a little.
Maybe this a little bit. Forgive me, this is neither the time nor the place for idle introspection. The knights can appraise Lord Edmund of our success, and we the Lord Commander. More importantly, I should like to see that my sister's condition is improved. You may take a moment to yourself if you wish. I will be at the congregation. Back to Monk. Before we speak to Emmerich here at the congregation, we're going to take a break of the break in videos. So I'm going to turn the stream off, and in a couple minutes, turn it back on, and we will resume. I'm trying to keep it from, instead of 5-hour videos, 2.5. So stay here. I'll be back. A couple minutes.